بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. ثم أما بعد proceed. Welcome back to the Saturday class. Inshallah, I hope that we will benefit from this particular course, maybe more than the previous course and the following courses. This is a particularly important course, and this will follow a little bit of a different format, because like we said, we will intersperse fiqh classes with tazkiyah classes, and tazkiyah classes have a different format from the fiqh classes. I'm not going to be using the board too often. We're not going to be having a PowerPoint presentation. Tazkiyah classes won't really call for the use of PowerPoint or the board too frequently. Maybe a few explanations here and there. And we will be reading from this book, and we'll go over the book, inshallah, and the author of the book quickly, briefly. But we will try as much as we can, or I will try as much as we can, as much as I can, to not branch off too often, because you're always tempted to branch off. And if we branch off, we will not be able to finish the course within a reasonable time. So the inner dimensions of the prayer is the course that we will go over, and we will try to go over it within the next 6 weeks, inshallah, so that we could move on to the next class. Not so that we could move on to the next class, so that we could finish it within a reasonable time for everyone to benefit from it, and to you know, not have a lot of dropouts, because we really want people to finish this particular course about the prayers. Why is it an important course? Because perfecting our prayers, particularly perfecting the inner dimensions of our prayers, is of utmost importance. This is the one thing that is too close to us to be seen by us. That whenever we are looking for ways or means to promote our iman, enhance our iman, strengthen our faith, strengthen our belief, increase our certainty, we're looking around, but the one thing that is extremely close to us may not be observed by us, because of it is extreme closeness. And there is a saying, "Min shiddat al-zuhur al-khafa," which means the things that are too close may not be apparent, or it may be concealed from you because of their closeness, because of their proximity. So we always talk about how do we increase our iman, how do we increase our faith, our certainty in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how do we find the sweetness of iman or the sweetness of faith. And we can have lists of things to do and things to read, but we don't pay enough attention to the prayers. And that should be our main source for the promotion, enhancement of our iman, our faith, and our connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the sila. Salah is the sila, is the connection, is the way to connect with our Lord, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that it is a very important course, and we do spend a lot of time also on perfecting the legalities or the technicalities. Now, I don't want to say technicalities prayer so that I'm not belittling the importance of perfecting the prayer the way the Prophet used to do it, or pray the way the Prophet used to pray. This is also part of devotion, and I repeat this so often, that correctness is an indication of devotion. Because when you're devoted to Allah, you're saying to Allah, "I worship you as you please, not as I please. I worship you as you please, not as I please." And no one knows what pleases you more than your messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I follow the messenger, and I follow the messenger, strictly, and I try to emulate his sunnah precisely to please you. So it is a sign of devotion. It is not about superficial technicality, is absolutely not. So correctness is important, but also the interior is more important than the exterior. And Allah had told us that, and the Prophet ﷺ had told us that. إِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةِ إِذَا صَلَحَ صَلَحَ جَسَدُ كُلُّ. And the Prophet ﷺ said there is like a piece of flesh inside the body that is rectified, the whole body is rectified. And he pointed to his heart. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَرْنُ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The day where when neither wealth nor offspring will be of any benefit except for one who returns to Allah with a heart that is sound, a heart that is salim, a heart that is sound. So the interior has a greater importance, which does not mean that the exterior is not important, but the interior does have a greater importance. And we seldom talk about the inner dimensions of the prayer, you know, or how to have more khushu', how to have more humility, submissiveness, tranquility and calmness in your prayer, which is the meaning of khushu'. Khushu' is about, you know, humility and tranquility. It is about submissiveness, humility and submissiveness, tranquility, calmness. And we do need to talk about this more, and we do need to make this an objective for ourselves, you know, perfecting our prayers, making sure that we get the most out of our prayers. This needs to be one of our main goals. If we need to be testing our prayers all the time. Are we finding peace in prayers? Are we finding contentment in prayers? Are the prayers the qurratul a'yun lana? Are they the comfort of our eyes or the comfort of our hearts? And like the Prophet ﷺ used to say to Bilal, give us comfort with it, O Bilal. Give us comfort. Go to the salah, let's have comfort in the prayers. Give us comfort with the prayers, O Bilal. So are we finding comfort in the prayers? Are we finding sweetness in the prayers? Are we able to connect? Are we feeling the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we pray? Are we truly conversing with Allah, or are we just making the recitation to finish off the Fatiha and then the short surah and move on to the ruku'ah and get done with the prayer? Oftentimes we have to be honest with ourselves. Oftentimes we come back from work and you want to pray awesome so that you could eat, so that you could just get it over with. You want to get it over with so that you could move on to the next sort of pleasant function of the day, which is having dinner. And that's part of the reason why the Prophet ﷺ said when the Isha and Asha come, when it is time, when the Asha is presented to you, or the Asha is presented to you, and it is time for Isha, have dinner first, have Asha first, before you pray your Asha, so that you're not distracted, so that you're getting the food over with, and then you're concentrating on your prayers. So we have to ask ourselves if we are enjoying our prayers, if we are yearning for our prayers, if we wait for the next prayer to have comfort and to have contentment. Oftentimes we don't. Many of us don't. And we have to be honest with ourselves that at least many times we don't. If we do many times, but many times we don't. Many times we're too distracted. Many times we're too busy. Many times we just want to pray so that we can move on. And that is a tragic loss. You know, each prayer where you do not give your 100% to it is a tragic loss. It's a missed opportunity. And it doesn't come back, unfortunately. So we have to make sure that each one of the five daily prayers, you're being mindful and you're giving your 100% to that prayer. That is your best opportunity to increase your faith, to promote your iman, and you have to have the sweet connection with your Lord, your Maker. This book, The Inner Dimensions of the Prayer, the translation, I like the translation of this book because he took the liberty to translate the meanings without being too strict or sort of too faithful to the letter. Because sometimes when you're too faithful to the letter, the language becomes a little too stiff, because every language has its own sense, own logic, own flow. So he was really not very, not too faithful to the letter, which made the translation flexible and made it a good translation, but he was also, he was not too reckless in his translation. It's not like too loose. He was still conveying the meanings with accuracy to a great extent. And we may point out a few things in the translation during this course, inshallah. But the Inner Dimensions of the Prayer is the loose translation for the أسرار الصلاة والفرق والموازنة بين ذوق الصلاة وذوق السماع. So the original title for this particular paper or chapter that Imam Al-Muqayyim wrote is أسرار الصلاة, which means the secrets of prayer, and the difference and the balancing between tasting the prayers literally and tasting songs and music, between the pleasure of prayers and the pleasure of listening to songs and music. So Imam Ibn Qayyim embarked on challenging the people who seek happiness and seek pleasure elsewhere to come to the prayers, Hayya ala salah, to come to the prayers and seek that happiness and pleasure in the prayers, and try with devotion to seek that happiness from the prayers. And the challenge here is that if you truly do this with devotion, you will be able to discover the huge difference, the enormous difference between looking for or seeking happiness, seeking pleasure, seeking contentment in songs and music and anything else. You know, it's not just songs and music, and we may, you know, elaborate on this a little bit more, inshallah, when we come to it. But from any source, any temporary source of happiness that people seek pleasure from, binge eating, you know, from frequent snacking, rocking your legs. People stimulate themselves in so many different ways. They're looking for gratification. They're looking for satisfaction. You know, check your Facebook status or check the status of your friends on Facebook, and then put your cell phone in your pocket, and then only to pull it out in 5 minutes and check your Facebook status or check the status of your friends. You're looking for, there is a discontented spirit here, a discontented soul that is looking for some pleasure somewhere, by looking into the fridge for something to eat or something to drink, or by trying to listen to music, or by trying to, you know, watch something or hear something. You're just looking to stimulate yourself. You're looking to basically please or appease that hungry, thirsty, discontented soul that is looking for its nurture, and you're not able to provide proper nourishment for it. So before we start with Imam Ibn Qayyim's book, like I said, I just wanted to tell you about the actual title, which is أسرار الصلاة والفرق والموازنة بين ذوق الصلاة وذوق السماع. And quickly go over very brief biography, not biography. I'll just briefly tell you about Ibn al-Qayyim, those of you who are not aware of him. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah was a great scholar of the 7th and 8th century, belongs more to the 8th century, because that's when he contributed to Islamic scholarship. He was born in the year 691 after Hijrah and died in the year 751 after Hijrah. 751 after Hijrah is when he died, born 691 after Hijrah, so he died at the age of 60 years. And there are some testimonials here about Ibn al-Qayyim that are sort of many good ones here, and I want you to read them all, but particularly relevant to the topic, to this particular topic, is one from Ibn Rajab and one from Ibn Kathir. May Allah bestow mercy on them. And Ibn Rajab and Ibn Kathir and Zahabi and Ibn Abd al-Hadi and those people are his contemporaries and his friends. And he had many teachers. The most famous of his teachers is certainly Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. But Ibn Rajab says this about Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. He said, he, may Allah have mercy on him, was constant in worship and performing the night prayer, reaching the limits in lengthening his prayer and devotion. He was constantly in a state of dhikr and had an intense love for Allah. So this is Ibn Rajab's testimony. Ibn Kathir says this, and I will read the last paragraph in Ibn Kathir's testimony. He says, and we're talking about Ibn Kathir, who had seen, you know, luminaries. This was like a time of blossoming, you know, in terms of Islamic scholarship. And Ibn Kathir had seen a lot of luminaries of his time, and he had learned from a lot of them. These people were the contemporaries of great imams, like I told you, and there is Badr al-Din ibn Jama'ah, and there is Qaydi al-Subki, there is Ibn Samarkandi as well, and others. Great scholars. Ibn Daqiq al-Aid was also one of their contemporaries. But Ibn Kathir says here, I do not know of anyone in the world in this time who is a greater worshipper than him. He's talking about Ibn al-Qayyim. His prayer used to be very lengthy with prolonged bowing and prostrations. His colleagues, you know, those luminaries, those great scholars, great imams, would criticize him for the length of his prayers. So they're just telling him, don't be excessive, just be moderate, give more time for rest, be kind to your body, things of that nature. They would criticize him for this, yet he never retorted back, nor did he abandon this practice. So this is someone who truly found sweetness in prayer. This is someone who truly found comfort in prayer. So whatever he has to tell us here about, you know, the prayers and the inner dimensions of the prayers must be very valuable. And it is coming from experience, not just from dry knowledge, not just from just like intellectual information. Okay, so let's not waste too much time, and let's start with what Ibn al-Qayyim has to tell us here. On page 16, chapter 1, with the name of Allah, the All-Merciful, the All-Merciful, the Most Merciful. That's how we translate it, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. So Imam Ibn al-Qayyim, Muhammad Ibn Abi Bakr Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. His name was Ibn al-Qayyim, or Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, because his father was the principal of Jawziyyah, you know, that school. May Allah bestow His mercy upon him, said, "This is a discourse on the inclination towards listening to music and songs versus the affinity to Salah and the Quran." And then later on he said it will also elucidate the inverse relation between the two inclinations. He's trying to say that these two things do not really coexist in one heart. You know, the love of the Quran and the Salah and the love of music and songs do not coexist in one's heart. And one of them will purge the other one out. There is an inverse relationship between the two. One of them will prevail, one of them will take over. So listening to songs and music, because I am quite sure that despite the fact that this is not about fiqh, and despite the fact that we should not branch off, but I'm quite sure that many of you will be saying, or some of you will be saying, does that mean that it is haram to listen to any songs, to listen to any music, to listen to any poetry, to listen to any rhythms? And is it a sign of weakness of faith whenever we do this? And is it a sign that we don't enjoy the Quran, we don't find pleasure in the Quran? Okay. No, it is not always a sign. Separate between two things at the outset of this discussion. Separate between songs and music. That's the first separation, the first important separation. Songs do not always entail the presence of music. And separate between music that is basically percussion instruments and the other forms of instruments, blow and string instruments and so on. Percussion instruments are permissible in certain cases and controversial in certain cases, but there is a separation here between percussion instruments and other types of instruments. So these are important separations at the outset of things. Separate between songs and music, separate within music between percussion instruments and other types of instruments. Why is it important that we separate? Because I cannot say that the Prophet ﷺ, who listened to poetry, did not enjoy the Quran. The Prophet used to listen to poetry, and he used to appreciate good poetry, and he used to have Hassan ibn Thabit recite his poetry inside the masjid. And I cannot also say that the Prophet who allowed the two young girls to sing for Aisha, and he said to Abu Bakr, "This is the day of our Eid, so let them sing, you know, leave them alone." I cannot say that the Prophet was allowing Aisha to do something that is haram or that is particularly inferior without pointing out to her that, you know, "I will let you do this time, but you shouldn't do it the next time," or something like this. And also the hidayah, when the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ya anjasha rifqan bil qawarir," "O anjasha, ruwaydak ya anjasha rifqan bil qawarir." This is reported by Bukhari and Muslim. So anjasha had a very beautiful voice, and he used to sing for, this is a marching rhythms. Hidayah is like marching rhythms. Like when you have a rhythm to, so when workers, laborers sing, when the Prophet and companions were digging the trench, they were singing, you know, "Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhirah, faghfir lil-ansari wa muhajira." You call this singing, you call this chanting, you call this recite, call it whatever. But it was rhythmic repetition of words that have rhymes. So that rhythmic repetition of words that have rhymes, whatever you want to call it, but that's what they were repeating. So Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhirah, oh Allah, there is no life except the life in the hereafter. Forgive the Ansar and the Muhajira. And certainly these are words that are suitable for the Prophet and the companions to be chanting, but it was to facilitate the digging of the trench. It was something like sort of lift up the spirit while you're working. Laborers all over the world do this while they're working, particularly hard labor, construction workers, and so on. They sing and they do things. people who march to the battlefield or march, people who are traveling on the bus, they may like to sing a song. And that is not inferior, because that would have not been permitted in the presence of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That all the Prophet said to Anjasha, who had this beautiful voice, is ruwayda, which means tone it down. Tone it down, Anjasha. Rifqan bil tawarir, be gentle to the fragile vessels, the women on the camels. And the tawarir, we translate it as fragile vessels, but be gentle to the delicate ones. Keep in mind that language itself is develops. That's a whole different discussion. So when you translate, be mindful of the audience and be mindful of the culture of the audience. So the Prophet ﷺ is saying to him, don't let the camels move too fast, or don't let the camels rock the women too hard. Be gentle to the women on the camels, because your voice, your beautiful voice, is just like overstimulating the camels and the mounts they were riding. So in this case, this rhythmic singing, while you're marching, while you're laboring, while you're sitting alone, if you want to have some temporary pleasure in listening to a song or listening to poetry or something of that nature, or if there is a particular event where you want to listen to something, such as the Eid, such as weddings, and so on, the Prophet ﷺ advised that they sing during weddings, and that they also use the duff during weddings. But you will find one thing that is particularly interesting, is that they did not really seek happiness in singing. They showed happiness by singing. And whenever it was during the Eid weddings and things of that nature that they exhibited, they showed happiness by singing. They were not looking for happiness in singing. And whenever they were singing, to stimulate for sort of like pleasure or stimulation, it was more like for the body, not the spirit. It was more for like marching rhythms, basically stimulate the body, not the spirit. So whenever they were looking for stimulating the spirit or contenting the spirit or pleasing the spirit, they did not really look for songs or music to do this. They found this in the Qur'an and in the Salah. And that is one big distinction. So we're not saying that categorically listening to songs is forbidden, or listening to good poetry is forbidden. We're just saying that the people who truly have a taste for the Qur'an and for Salah, they will be finding happiness in the Qur'an and in the Salah. When they're happy, sometimes they may show that happiness by singing. And when they want to basically stimulate the body or lift up the body, they may sing, such as when they are doing hard labor, things of that nature. As you will be able to trace in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, he was in the best conditions at all times, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whatever he did cannot be called inferior. The issue of music, why did I say that at the outset, let's separate music? Because most conservative Muslims, they believe that music is forbidden. I believe music is forbidden. The four different madhahib also clearly stated that music is forbidden. We're talking about non-percussion instruments here. We're talking about non-percussion instruments. They believe that music is forbidden. There are some great scholars who believed music is not forbidden, and I believe that this is an excusable difference. And I'm not saying it's an excusable difference to encourage you to listen to music, because I believe it is forbidden, and I believe the four imams said, the four madhahib said that it is forbidden, and I believe that there is, you know, it is enough that the four madhahib agreed on the prohibition, and that we have text of revelation that supports this, with the agreement of the four imams, then I believe that it is enough to deter us from this. But at the same time, we have to be also respectful to the other imams and the other ijtihad. There are those great imams who did not believe it is forbidden. The one that is particularly famous for this is Ibn Hazm, but he was not the only one. He's just the one who brought forth the strongest argument. So when I'm talking about singing from here on, I'm talking about singing without music, because that, at least in my book, is what is permissible. So I'm talking about singing without music. So listening to songs in this case would be okay and would be fine if it is not excessive. It is not haram content, words, you know, meanings. If it is not distracted, and it is not for the wrong reason. Okay. It is not excessive. Even if you're listening to good songs for the right reason and everything, but you're always listening to songs. That's a problem. That's why the four madhahib, they talked about karahat sama' dina, you know, that listening to songs is disliked. When you hear something like this, and then you hear that the Prophet ﷺ did listen to poetry and did allow Anjasha to sing for the caravan, and you say karaha. So did the Prophet ﷺ do something that's makruh? No, it means that outside of that context, of these contexts where the Prophet ﷺ did it, it would be makruh. So it would be makruh if you're doing it all the time. If you're being excessive about it, it would be surely it would be makruh. When will you have time for reflection? When will you have time for dhikr? When will you have time for Quran? When will you have time for peace and calmness, tranquility, quietness? When will you have time for your family? When will you have time for your work? When will you have time for serious business, for this life or the hereafter? When would you allow yourself to just some serenity? You're driving and you're listening to music, and people put their headphones in their ears while they're driving. That's crazy. Like, that is really crazy. So when you hear the scholar saying that it is this light, and then you say to yourself, so did the Prophet, you know, do something else? No, it's untrue. Did the Prophet, you know, allow Aisha to do something that is disliked without pointing this out to her? It's not true. She was listening on the Eid day. That would be fine. That's not excessive. Just like when we say that it is makruh to eat or drink while standing. But sometimes the Prophet drank while standing. So if this is done every once in a while, like you're out in the street and it is inconvenient to sit down and drink because you're out in the street. Generally speaking, if you want to eat or drink, sit down. You know, be mindful of this, you know, blessing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you, and sit down and eat. And by the way, there are dietitians who actually talk about mindful eating, that you make eating a ritual versus, you know, like sort of like on-the-go function. And if you there is actually a good amount of research on this issue. But what we're trying to say here is it would be okay every once in a while to listen to songs, as long as you're not being excessive about it, and as long as the content is reasonable. The content is reasonable means that there is no lewdness, there is no obscenity. But the Prophet ﷺ did hear, you know, Ka'b ibn Zuhair recite poetry that did have some ghazal in it. or they have some description of women in it. So if it is just like short glimpses of this, then it would be basically permitted, allowed to listen to the rest of the poetry. Banat Su'ad is the ode that Ka'b ibn Zuhayr chanted in front of the Prophet ﷺ, and in the beginning of it, following the customs of the Arab customs or the Arab poet's custom, it started by describing his beloved. So the Prophet ﷺ did not really censure this or did not reprimand them for it because it was their custom. But Banat Su'ad was not about describing women. That the ode itself was not about it. It's just the beginning of it. Which tells you that you would be sort of forgiving, particularly because artists, they do have their own culture and their own ways of doing things, that you would be more forgiving of slight wait a second.
Transgression?
Huh?
Transgression.
Yes,
it's a small transgression.
What
description?
Slight crookedness. Any
deficiencies.
Suboptimal, you know, things, but well, again, like, you know, if you're listening to if you're watching a documentary and there is music in the documentary, you're not actually intending to listen to the music. You're just listening to the documentary, the beneficial one, or the news, or anything. Then listening to music here is not listening; it's hearing. You're hearing, you're sama, you're not mustama. You're hearing, you're not listening, which would be fine in this case. So it's not excessive, it is not haram, and we said that there is a little bit of flexibility here with slight deviations, and it is not distracting, it doesn't distract you from things that are important and that are superior. And it is not for the wrong reason. It is not for the wrong reason means that you're not doing this to comfort your spirit, or to find pleasure, to find satisfaction, gratification, spiritual gratification, because that is not to be sought in music and songs. That is not to be sought in songs, even good songs, that you should not be trying to find comfort. A temporary one, yes. A temporary lifted up of the spirit by listening to a good song, maybe. But not for the permanent fix. Not for the cure. This is not a cure for the diseases of the heart. This is not a cure for the, basically, the tiredness of the spirit. This is just like someone who has an itch and keeps on scratching it. And he never goes to the doctor. And he never looks for treatment for his itch. You have been scratching. Every time you scratch your itch, you feel good, right? While you're scratching. Once you stop scratching, you're itching. And that is where, you know, that's exactly what people do when they, you know, eat for comfort, or listen to music for comfort, or watch something, or whatever the people do to find comfort. And certainly some people go to, you know, more excessive practices for comfort, and worse types of addiction for comfort. But there are many types of addiction, by the way, that are not called addiction. People do these, or people fall into them for comfort. So the true comfort of the spirit will not be found in the refrigerator. So, like, if you're going back and forth, if you find yourself going back and forth to the refrigerator to look for something to eat, and you're actually not hungry because you have just eaten dinner, you have to understand that your restless spirit is looking for nourishment. is looking for comfort, and it is not in the refrigerator. The same applies to listening to songs, and the same applies to checking your Facebook status, and the same applies to all forms of addiction. Okay, so that is that. As long as you're not excessive, you may be able to seek pleasures in these temporary sources of pleasure, but make sure that when your soul is hungry for nourisher and comfort, that you seek that from the prayers. Pray. Stand in the prayers. Say to yourself, like the Prophet ﷺ used to say, let's have comfort in it. Let's have comfort in the prayer. Then Imam Qayyim rahimahullah said, the salah is tranquility for worshippers and Allah's gift to the believers. It's imperative for you to know that salah is without any doubt the domain of tranquility for devotees, muhibbin. And I would translate muhibbin as lovers, because that is what muhibbin means, right? Devotees. Why are we too shy to say that we love Allah? You know, why are we shy to actually use the word? We love Allah. نَحْنُ نُحِبُّ اللَّهِ. We are His lover. The lovers, in that sense, has no negative connotations. We're just not going to walk away from, you know, beautiful meanings because of cultural connotations. Muhibb is a lover. It is imperative for you to know that salah is without any doubt the domain of tranquility for the lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the enjoyment of the souls of monotheists and muwahideen, the garden of the worshippers of abideen, the essence of enjoyment of the humble ones of khashi'een. And we said the humble, submissive, tranquil. Khushu'a is about all of this. The test of sincere ones, sadiqeen, the test of sincere ones, the scale measuring the medal of those embarking the right path, as saliqeen. Saliq, it is the taker of a path. It's the one who takes a path or seeks a path. So he says that this is the test of the sincere ones, and the scale measuring the medal. Medal here is the hal of the sincere ones, al-saliqeen. If you want to know your hal, your medal, your condition, in terms of your religious commitment, in terms of your connection with Allah, if you want to know where you belong on that journey, what phase you are at, where you belong, what is your position in the sight of Allah, how much have you covered in your journey, look at your prayers. Don't look beyond your prayers. Just look at your prayers and see how good your prayers are. See how fruitful your prayers are. Fruitful. Because your prayer, your moist prayer, it's like a moist tree, like a well-irrigated tree that is moist, that is lively, will bring about, you know, abundance of fruits. See how fruitful your prayer are. So see how content you are in the prayer. So you see how content you are by the prayer. And see how fruitful your prayer is by seeing the impact that the prayer will have on you afterwards, after you pray. Have you calmed down? Are you becoming a better person because of your prayers? Are your prayers making you a better person? Are you kinder? Are you gentler? Are you more truthful? Are you more basically responsive to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to every call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you more liked by the people? Yes, if you're truly excelling in your prayers, you will find that you will be more liked by the people. Your parents will like you more. Your spouse will like you more. Your neighbors will like you more, except for those who have trouble. But don't ever deceive yourself, fool yourself into believing that everybody around you has trouble. And the only reason why you don't get along with anyone, no one gets along with you, is that they're all crooked and you're the only straight one. Because that would be suicidal. That's spiritually suicidal. So are you being more liked? Are you being appreciated by your kids, your spouse, your neighbors, your co-workers, your parents, your relatives? That you come across. The prayer basically will make you in harmony with Allah, the creator of all things. Once you are in harmony with Allah, فَإِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ فَإِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ عَبْدًا, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved the servant, he would call upon Jibreel and tell him that I love him, so love him. And Jibreel calls upon the people, the dwellers of the heavens, that Allah loves him, so love him. And so on and so forth. And then, acceptance will be placed for him on earth. So, it's a test. Your prayer is a test. And your prayer is the measuring scale for your middle in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or with regard to your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's truly a divine mercy that Allah has gifted to His believing servants, that He has guided them to and acquainted them with. He delegated His truthful and honest messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to deliver this gift to His believing servants in order that they may attain a noble status with Him. And He chose for this particular gift that the Prophet go receive it up in the heavens. It did not come down. The Prophet went up to the heavens to receive this gift, and thereafter can convey it to us, and thereafter transfer it to us. Through its means, He dignifies, honors, and showers them with His mercy, that's His servants, and allows them to win His nearness. He bestows fasjud waqtarib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so prostrate and come near. Prostrate and come near. It is the best and sort of the surest means of nearness, closeness, proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fasjud, prostrate, waqtarib, and come nearer. That's what Allah said. So the more you prostrate, the closer you become to Him, Azza wa Jalla. He bestows upon His believing servants all this, although He is in no need of them. He just wants to lavish them with His gracious gift to show His favor upon them and bring them, their hearts and bodies, together into His servitude. He, the Most Exalted, endows the heart of the knower, the arif, the knower of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by enabling him to reap the best of its harvest. Turning to Him, exalted be he, rejoicing in His closeness, basking in His love, enjoying standing before Him in salah. You're standing before Him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to look at you as long as you don't look away, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us. You're standing before Him, you're conversing with Him, dismissing everything except Him from his heart as soon as he commences worship, and fulfilling the rites of his servitude to Him inwardly and outwardly in order for his worship to be in a manner that pleases Allah inwardly and outwardly. So you're perfecting your ruku' and your sujood, and you're also perfecting your khushu' while you're praying, your focus, your concentration, your humility, your submissiveness, your connection with Allah, your dependence on Allah. Then he says here, even as Allah tested his servants by creating them with innate lusts and desires, and I would translate this not as even as Allah tested, but since Allah, or because Allah, that because Allah tested his servants, or since Allah tested his servants by creating them with innate lusts and desires and exposing them to external temptations, his mercy and kindness mandated that Allah the Most High give his servants a feast. Ibn Qayyim calls this prayer ma'duban, banquet. It's Allah's banquet. Allah invites you to this banquet. It's a banquet for the nourisher of your spirit. Like I told you, it's not going to be in the refrigerator, the nourisher for your spirit. But this is the banquet that you should be seeking for the food of your spirit, the nourisher of your spirit. And Ibn Qayyim said that Allah provides us with five banquets every single day for the spirit. If you have three meals, Allah is giving you, for your body, Allah is giving you three meals, three banquets for your spirit. And Allah is giving you all forms of, like, diversified types of nourisher and foods for the spirit in this prayer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Ibn Qayyim is saying that we run through a lot of tests, and we come across a lot of tests, and tests can sometimes be hard, and lusts and desires and temptations and so on. And since we do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited us to those five daily banquets for the spirit. To rejoice in and to get basically the strength it needs to navigate all of the challenges and all of the tests and trials of life. So if you are coming to the salah so that you check one thing off the list of obligations and burdens, you're coming to the salah with the wrong spirit. You're coming to the salah for your supplies, for, you know, to seek strength, so that you could handle the rest of your religious commitment. Then he says, so the Most High gave his servants a feast comprising of several kinds of delicacies, nourishments, gifts, and grants, khula, to help them repel these desires and temptations. And he did invite them to attend this banquet on a daily basis, not once, but five times a day. And he distinguished each served course of this banquet with a unique flavor and a special benefit to perfect the pleasures and complement the benefits they attain and help them to perfect their ubudiyyah, servitude to Allah. Everything that you say in the Fatiha has a great impact, a great significance. If you reflect on what you're saying, if you understand what you're saying and you reflect on it, everything has a great impact. Ruku' has a great impact. Sujood has a great, and it has its own flavor, and it has its different impact on you. So then he says, unique flavor and special benefit to perfect the pleasures and complement the benefits they attain and help them to perfect their awadiyah, servitude to Allah. Thus, not only did he make every act of worship performed in salah a means of remedy to atone for the minor sins they committed, which is also another benefit of the salah, the atonement of sins. They wipe out, they erase, they cleanse all of your minor sins that you commit between them, as the Prophet ﷺ said, as-salatu ila salah, from prayer to prayer. He says, in fact, salah brings forth light and strength into the heart, increases the share of one's provision in this life, inspires others to love the one who prays. Like I said, because he will be loved by Allah. When you pray, you're bringing your body and your heart in harmony, in conformity with everything around you. Because all things praise, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sing the praises, exalt Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, exalt the praises of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around you. وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْتَهُونَ تَسْكِحَهُمْ. Yet you do not understand their glorification of Allah. The mountains, the birds, everything. إِنَّا سَخَرْنَا الْجِبَالَ يُسَبَّحْنَا إِنَّا سَخَرْنَا الْجِبَالَ يُسَبَّحْنَا مَعَهُ بِالْعَشِيِّ وَالْإِبْكَارِ وَالطَّيْرَ مَحْشُورَةً. So, إِنَّا سَخَرْنَا الْجِبَالَ يُسَبِّحْنَا مَعَهُ. We have subdued the mountains to glorify the praise of Allah with Him, as the wood, you know, early and late. And the birds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنْ مِنْ شَيْنِ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. There is nothing but to say that exalts the praises of Him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you do not understand their tasbih. So once you're in prayer, your body is in conformity, because your body is now in salah, your heart is in salah, and your body and your heart are in line with the rest of the creation around you. You're in complete harmony, in sync with the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you'll be loved by everything. And let the angels and also the earth with its mountains, trees and rivers rejoice. Rejoice in your return to Allah and your conformity to the divine will, which they had conformed with long before you. Then the next chapter, he says, before attending the feast, their hearts endured starvation, thirst, and nakedness. So he's talking about, you know, the diseases of the heart now. This nakedness is basically sickness. But as soon as they commence the worship, which is salah, all that shall change to become the opposite. Hence, they shall leave the feast with, he says, stomachs full, throats moistened, and bodies are tired. Well, we're talking about the spirit here. We're talking about the spirit, so it would be best to translate this as, they shall leave the feast with full, quenched, clothed, and well. Instead of with stomachs full. And I'm not really trying to be, his translation is certainly better than mine. These are my reflections. I'm not an English speaker, he probably is, he is. So I'm not picking on his translation, but I'm just, based on my understanding of the Arabic, and my understanding of the subject, these are my recommendations. So since we're talking about the spirit here, and Ibn al-Qayyim did not talk about stomachs or throats, he just talked about the spirit would walk away from the prayer, or leave the prayer, full, quenched, clothed, and well. Tangible descriptions for abstract concepts. These are descriptions that are tangible for abstract concepts, so that the idea may be clearer to us. So the spirit, just like the body, needs its nurture. So he's describing the spirit now as full, quenched, clothed, and well. Just like you would describe the body. But we're talking about the spirit after the prayer. So do we leave the prayer with spirits that are full, quenched, clothed, and well? That's what we will be trying to, you know, learn to do, inshallah. And inshallah, at the end of this course, it will help us embark on this journey. This course, no knowledge, because, you know, knowledge alone, without dedication, without sincerity, without devotion, without diligence, without work, without effort, no knowledge will make you move one inch. The Prophet ﷺ warned us about the scholars of evil. Ulama as-su. They have knowledge, they're called scholars, but they're scholars of evil. So as long as you put your knowledge to work with sincerity and devotion, no knowledge will make you move 1 inch forward or make you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by 1 inch without that sincere effort. So this course is to give us the tips, the knowledge that will enable us, that we will hopefully put to use so that we could enjoy our prayers and benefit from our prayers. Inshallah, after we come back from the 5 minute break, we will go over the types of cards that Imam Ibn Qayyim elaborated on here briefly before he moved on to start to addressing the secrets and essence of the Salah. Is that okay? So I'm showing us the